Hello, it's good to have you with us today. Welcome to the Amersham Methodist Circuit YouTube channel. I'm Nigel Wright, one of the ministers in the Amersham Methodist Circuit. We're going to start our time of worship today by singing together our first hymn, number 17, number 17 in Singing the Faith, With Gladness We Worship. Almighty God, we thank you for your great gift of love. Love which we are able to share with those around us. Love which gives us a sense of self-worth and belonging. Love which enriches us and the lives of those around us in so many different ways. Almighty God, we thank you for choosing to love us first before we ever responded to you. And for continuing to love us, even when we fail to return that love to you, or to pass it on to others. Loving God, we ask for your forgiveness. We ask for your help, to help us deepen our love for you and for one another. May we truly learn just how wide, long, high and deep your love for us is. And may we be willing to share and to show it with each other and with the world around us. Amen. We're going to continue in prayer by saying together the words of the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. Jill, who is the Church to Community worker at Chesham Methodist Church, will now read to us from Ephesians chapter 3. It's the Apostle Paul's prayer that his readers will be able to grasp how wide, how long, how high and how deep the love of Jesus Christ is. Ephesians chapter 3, verses 14 to 21.
Today's reading is taken from Ephesians 3, verses 14 to 21, from the New International Version. A prayer for the Ephesians. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whom his whole family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power, together with all the saints, to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the Church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, for ever and ever. Amen. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Part of our response to the width, length, height and depth of the love of Jesus Christ for us is for us to offer up our lives in spirit and truth, pouring out the oil of love as we worship him. We're going to sing now number 446, 446 in Singing the Faith, I Will Offer Up My Life.
Sing as an offering, Lord. What can I bring? What can I sing as an offering, Lord? I will offer up my life in spirit and truth, pouring out the oil of love as my worship to you. In surrender I must give my every part. Lord, receive the sacrifice of a broken heart. Jesus, what can I give? What can I bring to so faithful a friend, to so loving a King? Savior, what can be said? What can be sung as a praise of your name for the things you have done? Oh, my words could not tell, not even in part, of the debt of love that is owed by this thankful heart.
John, who is also from Chesham Methodist Church and who is one of the circuit local preachers, is now going to read to us from Matthew's Gospel, the story of a workers in the vineyard. It's Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 to 15. Matthew 20, verses 1 to 15.
Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 to 16. The parable of the workers in the vineyard. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About 9 in the morning he went out and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. He went out again about noon and about 3 in the afternoon and did the same thing. About 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found others still standing around. He asked them, "Why have you been standing here all day long doing nothing?" "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going on to the first." The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came, and each received a denarius. So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowners. "These who were hired last worked only 1 hour," they said, "and you made them equal to us who've borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day." But he answered one of them, "I'm not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I'm generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last."
We're going to sing another song now, one by Tim Hughes, a song that indicates that Jesus came into the world to open our eyes and to help us to see. The parable that John's read to us, a parable that Jesus told. Jesus helps us to see what the kingdom of heaven is like. Number 175 in Singing the Faith. Light of the world, you stepped down into darkness. Number 175.
Spent with you.
life can seem so unfair at times. It's not fair seems to be one of the phrases that the children learn when they're stopped from doing something that they want to do, or when they're not allowed to have something that they insist all their friends have, even if their claims are greatly exaggerated. But we seem to have an expectation, though, that life should be fair. I wonder, though, sometimes whether what we really want is to be treated more fairly than anyone else. But when things don't work out as we would have liked them to, we can so easily feel indignant. It's not fair. I've been at this company for years and have slaved away, and then this young upstart has been promoted over my head. It's not fair. I'm a good parent. I really, really love my children. But how come everyone else has perfect kids? It's only mine who have all the problems. It's not fair. I've lived a good, clean life. No smoking. I've tried to eat well. And now the doctor says I've got lung cancer. But my sister-in-law has smoked a pack a day for 40 years and is just fine. It's not fair. I've worked very hard to put this project together, and all that some people can seem to think about and criticise me for are some of the things I haven't done. It's not fair. You can probably think of many other examples of unfairness. In the end, our sense of fairness can be most keen when we feel that we are the victims of an injustice, or when we feel that someone else is treated more favourably than we are, and for no good reason. We don't like it so much, though, when it's turned on its head and the arguments are used against us. Is it fair that we, on the whole, have plenty to eat and drink, when so many throughout the world do not have enough? Is it fair that many of us have beautiful homes to live in, when so many people do not have any shelter over their heads at all? Is it fair that we have so much, when others have so little? It was some time ago now when I heard one of my ecumenical colleagues tell a story about some friends of his. They'd been upgraded on their flight because the economy class was full. And they were absolutely delighted to be sitting in much better seats than the ones they'd paid for. The only downside was that the people they'd joined in first class were not remotely happy. They were almost spitting with fury that these people who hadn't paid the full price were being upgraded. It seemed so unfair. And it seemed so unfair, too, to the workers who had worked all day in the vineyard, that they were only being paid the same as those who had just worked for the last hour. And it would do to us, too, if we were in the same position as them. But as the owner of a vineyard pointed out to them, he'd paid them the wage that he'd agreed with them. He wasn't cheating them out of anything that belonged to them. He was paying them the usual rate for a day's pay. What was it to them if he wanted to pay the same to those who'd only worked part of the day? It's a passage that a visiting speaker who came to speak to us as a group at university over 30 years ago now got us to think about. And this particular speaker divided us into four groups. One group taking the part of a landlord. One group taking the part of a manager of a vineyard. One group taking the part of the workers who had been hired first and who had worked all day. And one group, the final group, of those who had just been hired for the last hour. And we had a fascinating discussion about the parable and about how it struck the different people who were involved. If you ever get a chance to have a look at it in that way, looking at it with a group of people and dividing them up into groups to think about the different reactions. Do have a go. Produce some interesting results. So what's going on here? What sort of things are going on in this story, in this parable? First of all, there does seem to be some envy around, not at someone else having more, but about others having the same when they hadn't put in the same amount of work. And envy can be deadly. It can be deadly because it eats away at us inside. It prevents us from noticing how much God has blessed us, because we are always comparing those blessings with what someone else has received. And it starts to create resentment and anger inside us. And instead of directing our attention upon God and his goodness, we become self-centered and bitter. Envy is, of course, not limited to individuals. Churches can be envious too. Churches can be quite envious of other churches that have more members, a bigger budget, a nicer building, better music, a more dynamic preacher. Perish for thought. There's the danger that instead of helping each other to be disciples of Jesus and reaching out to others to help them to become disciples of Jesus too, we can be tempted to compare ourselves with a place down the road and miss our calling to work for the kingdom of God where we are. The workers in this story are envious, though, of those who have been paid the same. They are envious of the levelling up that's taken place. But when we think about it, who are likely to have been the labourers who weren't selected at the first round of hiring? I guess they're more likely to be those who perhaps aren't quite as physically or mentally able. They're likely to have been those who are older. They're likely to have been those who, for whatever reason, may not have been able to work a full day in the fields. Is there some kind of social justice message in there about taking adequate care of those in our society who can't as easily fend for themselves? The owner of a vineyard paid everyone a full day's pay. And could it be saying anything to us about other things in our society that could do with being levelled up? For example, good education for all, no matter where you might live. Equal opportunities for all. Equal treatment of all. Because sadly, people in our society are discriminated against because of the colour of their skin or because of where they grew up, and are not given the same opportunities as people who have had more privileged backgrounds. Going back to the passage, parables in the Bible are stories that Jesus told about everyday life. Jesus takes a common, everyday situation and tells a story that we can remember, often adding a twist in the tale to make a point. He puts heavenly meaning into earthly things, and we can all relate to them. And this passage is no different. This story was about day labourers being hired in the marketplace. Not a very familiar concept to us in 21st century Britain, but it would have been familiar not that long ago. And it would have been familiar to his listeners. And Jesus tells this story, and it has, as I mentioned earlier, a twist in the tale, as his stories so often do. His listeners might have been used to labourers being hired in the marketplace, but they wouldn't have been used to a vineyard owner like this one. One who paid those who only worked for a short time the same as those who worked all day long. But there are some things in this parable that don't seem to add up. Why would the owner of a vineyard go and do his own hiring if he had a manager in place? And why would the owner keep coming back to the marketplace to hire more people at different times of the day? Because surely he would know exactly how many people he needed to hire. And the thing that probably doesn't add up the most is the way that the workers were paid at the end of the day. He could have so easily avoided the complaints by paying the workers in the order that they had started. But let's not get too hung up on the details. Because after all, this is a story. And those things are there to make a point. Jesus, of course, was not really talking about a real vineyard owner, but he was talking about the kingdom of God and about what God was like. And God's values aren't necessarily the same as our human values. So what does this passage tell us about what God's like? About what a God of love looks like in practice? The first thing that strikes me from this passage is that God values every person equally. God values every person equally. We are all important to God. God's kingdom is not the world of George Orwell's Animal Farm, where some were more equal than others. In God's kingdom, we are all important, whatever our background, whatever our education, whatever we've done or been. We're all important to God, and God loves each and every one of us. And woe betide us if we think we deserve more from God because we've slaved away for him for years. The owner of a vineyard was willing to pay the same living wage to all those who were willing to work for him, even if they hadn't been working all day. The second thing that strikes me in this passage is the sheer generosity of a vineyard owner. And that's the basis of his retort to those workers who were questioning his employment practices. Verses 13 to 15, he says these things. But he answered one of them, "I'm not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree to work for a denarius? Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who is hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have a right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I'm generous?" And we see this same kind of generosity displayed throughout the Bible, Old Testament and New. In the words of the Bible, we see a wonderfully generous God who calls his people to display that same abundant and life-giving generosity. God offers us all new life, eternal life with him, whether we've been one of his servants for the whole of our lives or just the final 5 minutes. Now that can seem to be very unfair when looked at with our human eyes. But those who have worked throughout their lives for God are treated the same as those who came into God's kingdom for the last few minutes of their lives. It's a bit like what the older brother complains about in that fantastic parable of a lost son that Luke tells us. The older brother refuses to celebrate his younger brother's return home and accuses his father of never giving him even a goat to celebrate with his friends, despite having slaved away for him for many years. Whereas when his younger brother returns home after wasting his money, he is treated to the fatted calf. But I would much rather serve a God who loved everyone equally than one who had his favourites. Wouldn't you? It would be a capricious God indeed who had his favourites, a bit like the mythological gods of the Greeks and the Romans. Because who's to say that we would be his favourites? We might get a very nasty shock. But instead, those who do serve him throughout their lives have a privilege of getting to know God, of drawing closer and closer to him, of developing their relationship with him over the years, of seeing that God can be trusted, that God can be relied upon, that God is alongside us in all the events of our lives, of seeing his love for every single human being, of participating in his desire for all to come to know him. These and privileges that we have, of sharing in his work and seeing him in action in the world, of us working with him and he working in us and through us. But if we come away, though, feeling that this passage from Matthew's Gospel is fundamentally unfair, then let us reflect for a moment that our God is unfair. That our God is unfair, unfairly generous, unfairly loving, unfairly gracious, and that we are the recipients of that unfair generosity, that unfair love, and that unfair grace. We don't get what we deserve, fortunately. Just as well, really. Because there's nothing any of us can ever do to earn God's favour. All that we can do is to open our hands to receive his love, his grace, his favour, his generosity, and to invite him in to transform our lives. What a wonderfully unfair, generous, loving, and gracious God we have. Amen. We're now going to sing a hymn by Fred Pratt Green that gives thanks to God for the generosity that we see. It's number 124 in Singing the Faith, number 124, for the fruits of all creation. Thanks be to God.
Of all creation, thanks be to God. For the gifts to every nation, thanks be to God. For the ploughing, sowing, reaping, silent growth while we are sleeping, future needs in earth safekeeping, thanks be to God. In the just reward of labour, God's will is done. In the help we give our neighbour, God's will is done. In our worldwide task of caring for the hungry and despairing, in the harvest we are sharing, God's will is done. For the harvest of the Spirit, thanks be to God. For the good we all inherit, thanks be to God. For the wonders that astound us, for the truths that still confound us, most of all that love has found us, thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the unfair generosity, unfair love and unfair grace that you bestow upon us. We thank you that you do have no favourites. We thank you that you love each and every person equally, whatever we may have done and whatever we may have been. We pray that you will help us to share and to show that same spirit of generosity, love and grace to those we live with, to those who are part of our families, to our neighbours and work colleagues, and to the world around us. Prompt us when we pray with the names of those you want us to help. And we pray for all those who are on our hearts and minds in a few moments of silence. We pray for our Prime Minister and for his cabinet, for wisdom and guidance about how best to tackle all the issues of COVID-19, including the matter of test and trace. We pray for him and them too about how to handle Brexit, for wisdom and guidance. We pray for all the churches in the Amersham circuit as they move towards reopening their buildings for worship and community activities. And this morning, we pray for the congregation at Prestwood Methodist Church, who are reopening for worship today for the first time since lockdown. And using the theme suggested by the Methodist Prayer Handbook for today, we pray for the church in China and Hong Kong. And we echo the words of François Fenelon, French Roman Catholic Archbishop, theologian, poet and writer of the 17th century. In our weakness, O Christ, let us trust your strength. In our darkness, let us see your light. In our doubt, let us feel your presence. And in our despair, let us cling to your cross, for your truth and your mercy's sake. Amen. And we bring all these our prayers to you, Almighty God, in the name of our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to end our service today by singing number 566 in Singing the Faith, number 566. Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to thee. Number 566.
And I will be ever old.
as you've come to worship, so go now to serve, showing the truth in your lives of what you've declared with your lips. And the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forevermore. Amen.